Hello and good afternoon, friends. Welcome to the CEC EDUSET live lecture. Dear friends, as you may know that this session of ours is all dedicated to the science. And today, in this very session, we are going to discuss about animal diversity non-correlata. And we are going to continue this lecture in two sessions, that is today and tomorrow. So what basically this topic is, for this we have in our studios Dr. Renu Gupta. She is Associate Professor in Ramjas College, Delhi University, and she has been into the teaching profession since 20 years, I would say more than 20 years in fact, for her immense contribution to the field of education, to the field of academics. So what basically this topic is, for all the students who might be watching us, here for you, we have this topic for you all the way from Dr. Renu Gupta. Hello ma'am, welcome to the EDUSET lecture.
Thank
of
you,
ours, and I would like you to explain to all the students who are watching us what actually this topic is.
Actually, today we are going to talk about the animal diversity. As we know, the all around us, lot of variety of animals are there. Wherever we go, we are able to find or point out some kind of animal, whether they are as small as mosquito or housefly, or it may be bigger animals like dogs and cats. So diverse forms of animals are present all around us. And before starting with this series on animal diversity, I would first like to take my viewers to have a glimpse of the animal world, which is really fascinating and amazing. So, welcome to your kingdom, the animal kingdom. It is more, or we can say, far beyond humans and other animals we may encounter. I am saying it as your kingdom because I think all of us know, we the human beings, Homo sapiens, belong to the kingdom of animals as the member of the most evolved group, or the most highly evolved group of animals, the primates. No one exactly knows how many and different kinds of animals are present on this earth. We know that more than 1 million species of animals have been described so far, and there are many more to be discovered. There is diversity amongst animals. The animals are different from each other in color, shape, size, structure, and even in their habit and habitats. So, wherever we go on this earth, we will be able to find some form of the animal. Even we go deep inside the oceans, even at the depth of 11,000 meters, you will be able to find some kind of animal life. Even the animals are present on the snow-covered mountains, even in the frozen Antarctic, where the temperature may reach minus 35 degrees centigrade or below that, the animal life is possible. Even some forms of animal are present in the deserts where the temperatures are extreme and rainfall is almost nil. So in this case, we say when they are diverse in form, and if we want to study all these diverse forms, it will be really difficult to study any kind of animal or the plant form without assigning them a particular group. Like, all these animal forms or the plant forms, they are known as the species in biological terms. And if we want to study about a species, we have to study the characteristics of the species and what relationship it has with the other species present near it. So there was an art, or there is a science which deals with arranging these plants and animals into groups on the basis of their similarity and relationship, and this branch of science is called as the classification. So, and the branch of science which deals with identification, nomenclature meaning the giving of a particular name and then assigning it a particular category, it is called as the taxonomy. Ernst Mayr, he was a German-born American, and he made lot of discoveries in the field of avian taxonomy. He was a great evolutionary biologist, And first of all, he gave the definition for the species. So all the different plants and animals around, they represent a kind of species. All the plants and animals which are present on this earth, they total about 1.5 million species. And if we want to study them, it will be really difficult without classifying them. So the previous taxonomic system, which dates back to the time of Aristotle, he was a great Greek philosopher. He proposed a classification system in which two kingdoms were there, kingdom Plantae and kingdom Animalia. So we know the basic difference between plants and animals. Plants generally immobile and animals are mobile. Plants, they are able to manufacture their own food during the process of photosynthesis in the presence of sunlight. So generally we call these plants as the autotrophic organisms, whereas the animals are called as the heterotrophic organisms. It means they depend upon plants or the other organisms for their food. When we talk about plants and animals, there were many unicellular forms of organisms like Euglena and Volvox, which showed the characteristics of both plants and animals. Like Euglena and Volvox, they have got chlorophyll in their cell, and with the help of which they are able to photosynthesize. It means they produce their own food just like the plants, and they have got the locomotory structures in the form of flagella, and they are able to move like animals. So with the problem of this kind of animals to be classified, this two kingdom classification was found to be insufficient. So in 1866, Haeckel proposed a third kingdom called as kingdom Protista, in which he placed these organisms like Euglena, amoeba, Volvox and other unicellular organisms in the third kingdom, that is kingdom Protista. So according to the classification of Haeckel, which is called as the three kingdom classification, the three kingdoms are kingdom Protista, kingdom Plantae and kingdom Animalia. Later on, the other classification schemes, they were not able to put fungi in the proper place, and to overcome this problem, in 1969, Robert Whittaker proposed a system with five kingdoms. And these five kingdoms were kingdom Monera, kingdom Protista, kingdom Plantae, kingdom Fungi and kingdom Animalia. Kingdom Monera, it comprises the prokaryotic cells or the bacteria and the viruses and other organisms, where the Protista comprises of the eukaryotic unicellular organisms, Plantae, Fungi and Animalia, we all are familiar with. This five kingdom classification, according to the modern biologists, they are still working on them, and they are trying to restructure this five kingdom classification. And in modern times, many of the scientists are adopting a three domain system. And this three domain system includes the domains archaea, bacteria and eukarya. And each domain has been split by taxonomists into many kingdoms. Like the kingdom Eukarya has been divided into kingdom Animalia, Fungi, Plantae and Protista. And as our topic is animal diversity, we will like to focus on Animalia only. And this kingdom Animalia comprises a number of phyla like Annelida, Arthropoda, Chordata, Cnidaria, Ctenophora, Echinodermata, Mollusca, the list is long. And further, these phyla can be categorized into number of subphyla, which for convenience can be grouped into lower categories, which are called as the classes. If we look at the animal diversity, so more than 1 million species of animals have been described so far, and still number of them are there which have to be explored and have to be given a proper name and classification scheme. So when we look at the animal diversity, we can say that there are only 5% animals which have a vertebral column, and in this figure they have been put under the category of amphibians, mammals, reptiles, birds and fishes. They form only 5% of the total animal diversity and put under the category vertebrates. It means the rest of the animals are belonging to the other category, which we generally call as the invertebrates. So these two terms we come across, invertebrates and vertebrates. And as the name suggests, this naming is on the basis of presence of vertebral column. If the animals have got the vertebral column, they are called as the vertebrates. And if they do not have any vertebral column to support their body, they are called as the invertebrates. There are other two names for these terms, like invertebrates and the vertebrates, which are, I can say, rather more scientific: non-chordates and chordates. And this naming or this division of animalia into non-chordata and chordata is on the basis of a structure which is present during the embryonic development, and this structure is called as the notochord. This notochord is a solid mass of mesodermal cells which is present in embryo but later on gives rise to vertebral column. It means if the notochord is present, the animals will be called as the chordates, and if the vertebral column is absent, then the animals will be called as non-chordates. It means we can say that all non-chordates are invertebrates, because if they are not having the notochord, there is no question of forming a vertebral column. So now we are dividing the kingdom Animalia into two main groups, non-chordata and chordata. And we are dividing this whole series of lecture into two parts: animal diversity non-chordata and animal diversity chordata. So today, in today's lecture, we are going to start to talk about the animals which belong to group non-chordata. The non-chordates, as I told you, without the vertebral column, they are generally the multicellular organisms, and these multicellular organisms are of varied form. They can be small size or large size. But before starting our talk on the multicellular organisms, I would like to focus your attention towards the group of unicellular organisms or the kingdom Protista. As I have already told you, kingdom Protista is a separate kingdom from the kingdom Animalia. But zoologists still claim the protozoans to be their own. The protozoans are treated as primitive ancestral organisms from which evolved the multicellular organisms. These unicellular forms, which live in colonies, may have given rise to the multicellular organisms during the course of evolution. These unicellular organisms, the protozoans, they show many characteristics which are similar to that of the higher animals, or we can say the multicellular animals. They are heterotrophic. It means they ingest their food. They have got specific locomotory organelles. They reproduce sexually. In many of the colonial forms, there is division of labor among the members. And because of all these animal-like characteristics, we would like to focus on protozoa as the ancestors of multicellular animals, and this part is going to focus on the protozoa. So the question arises, what the protozoans are. The protozoans, which belong to the kingdom Protista, they are diverse in habitat. You are able to find the protists in different kind of environment. They are found in freshwater, seawater, estuaries, in soil, and many of them are present in the bodies of even the human beings and other animals. The general features of protozoans: about 64,000 species of the protozoans have been named, and half of them are present, or you can say the fossils of half of the forms are there. They have already become extinct. They are unicellular organisms, but they have got cell organelles which are highly specialized. they are ecologically diverse, but many of them are limited to very narrow environmental ranges. They can be numerous in number, and many of the shelled forms of protozoans, they form gigantic ocean soil deposits. About 10,000 forms of protozoans are symbiotic. They are present inside the animals or on the animals or plants, and many of them are the pathogenic. They cause serious diseases in the human beings. Many of the protozoans are colonial with multicellular stages, but they also have got the non-colonial forms. It means they can live solitarily. If we talk about the structural organization of protozoans, they have got a specific shape and size. Their body is generally bound by the cell membrane, which is called as the plasma lemma. The cytoplasm inside the cell is differentiated into two layers. The outer one is called as the ectoplasm, and inner one is called as the endoplasm. The ectoplasm is a more rigid form of the colloid, whereas the endoplasm is the more fluid state. The endoplasm contains the nuclei and other cytoplasmic organelles. The number of nuclei inside the body of protozoan vary. It can be one or two or many nuclei are present in many of the protozoans. Many of the protozoans have an exoskeleton which is present in the form of shell or theca. So this exoskeleton provides protection to the body of protozoans. The shell is formed of varied material. It may be formed of an organic material called chitin, or simply the sand grains glued together to form a shell. Many of the protozoans secrete a calcareous shell. It means made up of calcium carbonate, or shell may be made up of silica. These shells, when the protozoans die, they deposit at the bottom of the sea and result in an enormous mass at the sea bottom. Many of other protozoans, they have got a hard covering around them, around the plasma lemma, which is called as the theca. And this theca is generally made up of cellulose. Some protozoans have an internal cytoskeleton, which provides rigidity as well as flexibility to the body. The internal cytoskeleton is composed of filamentous proteins, microtubules, or vesicles. If we talk about the locomotion in protozoans, they have got different kind of structures. They move either by pseudopodia or flagella or cilia, or with the help of these structures, they are able to direct their own movement. The pseudopodia, all of us know, I think from our very childhood, we know about amoeba. We have always seen the structure of amoeba in our class books. And amoeba is a simple irregular mass, we can say, of cytoplasm. And the projections which arise because of the flow of cytoplasm, those cytoplasmic projections are simply called as the pseudopodia. And these pseudopodia again may be of varied types. If they are the blunt projections, they are called as the lobopodia. If they are of a finer filamentous structure, they are called as the phyllopodia. And if they are supported by some kind of internal skeleton, they are called as exopodia. So, the different forms of pseudopodia are lobopodia, exopodia, phyllopodia. They occur in different forms of protozoans. When we talk about the cilia and flagella, they are simple hair-like structures present on the body of the protozoans. Cilia are generally smaller than flagella. They are more in number, and cilia are generally present in rows. Flagella, generally a long thread-like, whip-like structure. A single individual can have one or two flagella. A uniflagellated animal like Euglena, and we have always seen Chlamydomonas with two elongated flagella. So with the help of these flagella and cilia, the protozoans are able to perform definite movements. So this structure of the locomotory organelles, they can be compared in this way to the higher organisms, the multicellular organisms. If we talk about the reproduction in the protozoa, they are able to reproduce by both the means of reproduction, that is asexual reproduction and sexual reproduction. Asexual reproduction may take place by fission, budding or cyst formation. Fission may be again of varied types. It may be binary fission or may be multiple fission. In the binary fission, a single parent cell generally divides into two equal daughter cells. While in case of budding, the young one or the bud which is given off from the parent cell is generally of a smaller size than the parent cell. The sexual reproduction can be achieved by two methods mainly, either by syngamy or by conjugation. Syngamy involves the complete fusion of the two sex cells or the gametes, whereas in conjugation, which is peculiar of paramecium, the two individuals come together, and these two individuals are known by the name of conjugants. They come together, they partially unite with each other temporarily, and during this partial union, transfer of genetic material takes place, and after the transfer, the two conjugants are going to separate out. So this conjugation is a means of rejuvenation or means of change of the genetic material, which results in the renewed progeny of the animals. On the basis of these variations in the body form, in the locomotory structures, on the basis of the type of reproduction, the protozoans can be grouped into three major phyla and four minor phyla. And these three major phyla are phylum Sarcomastigophora, phylum Coelophora, and phylum Epicomplexa. First of all, we take the phylum Sarcomastigophora, and the characteristic feature for this that the animals belonging to this group, they have got pseudopodia or flagella as the locomotory structures. They have got nuclei which are of one kind. In the scientific term, we say the nuclei are of monomorphic type. They reproduce sexually and generally through syngamy. This phylum Sarcomastigophora is a big phylum and has got a variety of protozoans, and they can be further subdivided into three subphylum: subphylum Mastigophora, subphylum Opelinata, and subphylum Sargodina. Subphylum Mastigophora, which have only the flagellated protozoans. The flagella may be one or may be many. This mode of reproduction, it is asexual. And this subphylum Mastigophora is further divided into two classes, class Phytomastigophora and class Zoomastigophora. This Phytomastigophora and Zoomastigophora, as the name suggests, is on the basis of the presence of chlorophyll. The Phytomastigophorans are more plant-like organisms. They have got chlorophyll, and with the help of chlorophyll, they are able to synthesize their own food. So we can say they are autotrophic, and examples are Euglena, Volvox. And for the Zoomastigophorans, the chlorophyll is absent and they are heterotrophic, and most of the organisms or the protozoans belonging to this class are pathogenic. It means they are responsible for causing number of diseases in human beings. Like Leishmania, it causes kala-azar in human beings. Then there is trypanosoma, which causes sleeping sickness in African subcontinent. Then there is one interesting example of this Zoomastigophorans. One genus, which is called as Trichonympha, it is present in the alimentary canal of the termites. I think all of us know about the termites, which attack the wood, any material made up of wood, furniture or the trees. And when they eat on wood, they have to digest the cellulose. But the termites, they don't have the cellulose digesting enzymes, and they have to depend on Trichonympha for the digestion of cellulose, which is living inside the alimentary canal of these termites. So these are the interesting example of association of different kinds of organisms in nature. This is an example of Euglena, which is having a single flagellum. It is a solitary phytomastigophoran. This is Volvox, and it is a colonial protozoan, and this is again having the chlorophyll inside the cells. The next subphylum, Opelinata, it is in this case the entire body is covered by cilia-like structures and number of nuclei are many. The whole body is having number of nuclei and all the nuclei of the same type. The example for this is Opelina. The third subphylum is subphylum Sargodina. The body is mostly amoeboid and locomotion is generally by pseudopodia. And in the Sargodina comes the amoebas, the entamoebas and other interesting group of protozoans, the radiolarians and foraminiferans. I think all of us are familiar with the entamoebas. Whenever we face dysentery in the case of human beings, then we say that it is entamoebasis. So Entamoeba histolytica is the causative agent which causes amoebic dysentery in humans. And the other species of Entamoeba are parasite of vertebrates and some invertebrates. The other example of sarcodines, they are the foraminiferans, beautiful organisms, and they have got a well-developed shell which is either calcareous or maybe siliceous. So they have got a shell which may be made up of a single chamber or maybe multi-chambered shell. The pseudopodia in foraminiferans extend through the pores of the shell, and these shells form the marine sediment and which becomes a source of fossil study for the zoologists. The other group of sarcodines called as radiolarians, they are again the marine protists, and in this case the exoskeleton, which is called as test, it is fused into one delicate piece which is generally made up of silica. The pseudopodia of radiolarians, they are filamentous thin needle like projections, they radiate out from the central body and they are known by the name of exopodia. Next comes the phylum Coelophora. So as the name suggests, the members of this phylum, they have cilia on their body. And the other distinctive feature is that they possess two types of nuclei. One is larger in size, which is called as the macronucleus, and the other is smaller in size, which is called as the micronucleus. So the famous example for this is the paramecium. The ciliates, a large varied group of protists, and they use cilia for their movement and even for the feeding purposes. The micronuclei function during conjugation, and which is a sexual process and which produces the genetic variation in the organisms. Vorticella, a beautiful ciliate. The paramecium having two nuclei, one large and a small, and the whole body on the margins is covered by a layer of cilia. There is the process of conjugation, and during which the exchange of genetic material takes place. The third phylum is called as the phylum Epicomplexa. The name Epicomplexa denotes the presence of a complex of organelles which is present at the apex, or we can say at the anterior end. This apical complex helps the animal in penetrating the host cells and the tissues, because all the epicomplexans are parasites of animals and they cause serious human diseases. Most of the epicomplexans, they have got a complicated life cycle. This life cycle will be involving two phases, the asexual phase and sexual phase. And for completion of their life cycle, they have to depend upon two hosts. Like we know the example of malarial parasite, the Plasmodium, which is responsible for spread of malaria in human beings. And the two hosts for this malarial parasite are the mosquitoes and the human beings. The mosquitoes act as vectors for spreading this pathogen. About this particular malarial parasite, we will be talking in detail, and this lecture will be delivered by Dr. Amit Bhattacharya in coming few days. So, till now we have studied about the protozoans in great detail, which are supposed to be the ancestors of the multicellular animals, and now we can proceed on to the multicellular animals, or we can say the whole group of animal diversity which we see all around. So, before starting with the diversity of multicellular organisms, I would like to draw your attention towards some basic fundamental features by which we can describe an animal, its structure or its development pattern. So, these fundamental features make an animal different from the other. So, all the animals, or we can say all the multicellular animals or all the metazoans, they have got a definite body shape, and this body shape is either asymmetrical or symmetrical. When we talk about the symmetry of the animals can be of two types, either radial symmetry or bilateral symmetry. The meaning of radial symmetry: if we arrange the structures or the organs of an organism around a central axis, just like the spokes of a wheel, and we divide the body along a central axis passing through the center of the body, we are going to get two equal or two identical halves. So, this is called as the radial symmetry, and this is seen in the group of organisms called as cnidarians, called as jellyfishes, sea anemones, starfishes, and many other organisms. The other type of symmetry is called as the bilateral symmetry. Even the human beings show the bilateral symmetry. So, in the bilaterally symmetrical animals, if we pass a plane through the center of the body, passing from anterior to the posterior end, it will result in two identical halves, or we can say the right and left halves are going to be similar to the each other. So, in this case, the bilateral symmetry, only two equal halves can be produced through a single plane. But in radial symmetry, any number of planes can pass through the center, and it will always result in two identical halves. Bilaterally symmetrical animals, they generally have a dorsal side and a ventral side, and we can say they have a right side and a left side. The tendency is towards the formation of a head, which is called as cephalization, at the anterior end, and posterior end is generally referred to as the tail end. If we look at the early embryonic development in animals, first of all, after the mating, after the fusion of the male and female gametes, the result is formation of a single cell, which is called as the zygote. And this zygote is going to form a multicellular animal. So, this zygote divides by number of mitotic divisions, which are called as the cleavages, and result in the formation of a ball of cells, which is called as the blastula. So, blastula has got the cells, which are going to get arranged in three germ layers in the coming stage, which is called as the gastrula. In gastrula, the rearrangement of cells take place. Some of the cells remain on the outside and they form the ectoderm layer. Many of the cells move inside and they form the endoderm layer. And between the ectoderm and endoderm, the third layer of cells is formed, which is called as the mesoderm. So, we can say the developing embryo has got three germ layers: outermost ectoderm, innermost endoderm, and in between is the mesoderm. But many of the animals have got only two germ layers, the ectoderm and endoderm, and these animals are called as the diploblastic animals. And those animals which have got three germ layers in them, they are called as the triploblastic animals. These three germ layers, the ectoderm, endoderm and mesoderm, they are responsible for the formation of different organs in the body. All body organs like the nervous system, the skin, the alimentary canal, you name any organ, all these organs are derived from only these three germ layers. In triploblastic animals, generally a body cavity is present or it may be absent. So the other name for body cavity, it is called as the coelom, and it is derived from the mesoderm. So all those animals which have got a true body cavity, they are called as the coelomates. And this example, like the earthworm, it has got a true coelom, and in this case the middle layer, the mesoderm layer, splits into two parts and the body cavity appears between the two layers of the mesoderm. This lining of the mesoderm is called as the peritoneum, and all the internal organs are suspended inside the coelom. But many of the organisms like the nematodes, they don't have a body cavity, and many of them like the nematodes, they have got a pseudocoelom. Pseudocoelom means the false cavity. It is a body cavity which is derived from the blastocoel, which is the cavity of blastula. So in this case, the body cavity is not derived from mesoderm, and therefore it is called as a false cavity or pseudocoelom. The other organisms like the platyhelminths, they have got a kind of solid constitution. They do not have a body cavity, or the space between the ectoderm and endoderm is completely filled with the mesodermal cells. And this solid, because of this solid body structure, they are considered or called as acoelomates, the animals without the body cavity. On the basis of all this embryonic development, we come across two terms which are called as protostome and deuterostome. So what is the meaning of this protostome and deuterostome? So this is on the basis of early development. The animals can be categorized as protostomes or the deuterostomes. As the name is suggesting, protostome. Proto means first, and stome refers to stomium, which means the mouth. So the mouth is going to develop as the first opening of the embryo. During the development, the blastopore, which is the opening of blastula, it results in the development of mouth, and therefore all those animals in which the blastopore becomes the mouth are called as protostomes. While in the other category of animals, the blastopore does not result in the formation of mouth, and it gives rise to the anus. So mouth develops as a second opening. That is the meaning of deuterostome. Deutero means second, stomium for the mouth, and mouth is developing as a second opening because the blastopore gives rise to the anus. If we look at the cleavage pattern in protostomes and deuterostomes, the cleavage pattern is spiral and determinate in protostomes. Spiral cleavage refers to the spiral arrangement of blastomeres over each other. And the meaning of determinate is that the fate of these blastomeres is determined at an early stage of development, while in case of deuterostomes, the type of cleavage is radial and indeterminate. The blastomeres are arranged radially over each other, and their fate is determined at a later stage, and therefore this pattern of cleavage is called as the indeterminate pattern of cleavage. If we look at the pattern of coelom formation in protostomes and deuterostomes, again the variations are there. In protostomes, the mode of coelom development is called as schizocoelous development, whereas in deuterostomes, it is called as enterocoelous development. The schizocoelous development, the mesoderm, which is present between the ectoderm and endoderm, that splits into two layers and is resulting in the formation of coelom. Whereas in the case of enterocoelous development, the archenteron, that is the gut, gives rise to two paired pouches on the sides, and these two paired pouches are going to get detached from the archenteron and result in the development of cavity around the archenteron, and that forms the coelom. And as this coelom formation is from the archenteron, this type of development is called as the enterocoelous development. On the basis of these variations, as we have seen, the variations in the symmetry, the radial symmetry and bilateral symmetry, variations in the developmental pattern, variations in the presence of coelom, pseudocoelom, acoelom, or the true coelom, pattern of development resulting in the protostomes and deuterostomes, we can classify all these organisms into various categories. Like the cnidaria is coming as the branch of the radiata, it means showing radial symmetry. The bilateria means the animals showing the bilateral symmetry. They can be the different types of worms, the molars, the arthropods, or it can be the echinoderms. And in these group, on the basis of the coelom, we can divide them as pseudocoelomates. The nematodes are called as the pseudocoelomates. The platyhelminths called as the acoelomates. And the other organisms, the other forms like the mollusca, annelida, arthropoda, all of them are considered as truly coelomate animals. When we talk about the protostomes and deuterostomes, in the non-chordata, the rest of the phyla, starting from porifera, cnidaria, helminths, annelida, mollusca, and arthropoda, all of them are put under the category of protostomia. It means in all these animals, during the development, the mouth is the first opening to be developed, whereas the phylum Echinodermata, to which belongs the starfishes, the other kind of brittle stars, sea cucumbers or sea lilies, all these forms, they show deuterostome kind of development. It means the phylum Echinodermata is the highest placed group of animals among the non-chordates. And the other group of organisms which show the similar kind of pattern of development, that is the protostomium development, that is of the chordata. So on the basis of these features, we can say that among the non-chordates, it is the echinoderms which are quite similar to the other higher forms of animals, that is the chordates. On the basis of the study of all these variations in the animals, in the basis of their characters, on the basis of their difference in shape and sizes, we are able to recognize about 35 animal phyla. And these 35 animal phyla show variation in forms, in structure, function, habit, and habitat. So we are going to talk about these animal phyla in details in our coming lectures.
Okay. So, ma'am, if we talk about, as you talked about, non-chordata, if we categorize animal diversity in non-chordata and chordata, what is the difference between the two, if we differentiate between the two?
So, as I told you even in the lecture, the name is suggesting non-chordata and chordata. Mm-hmm. So, this is on the basis of a structure called as notochord. Mm-hmm. Since this notochord develops during the development of embryo, it is a solid rod of cells made up of mesodermal cells, and this gives rise to vertebral column in the young ones. So if the notochord is present, we call these animals as the chordates. If notochord is absent, the animals will be referred to as the non-chordates.
So this is the basic difference we can talk about. If we talk about slightly apart from this very subject, with this very topic, in what stages do we study about this very topic, if we talk about the curriculum as alone?
In our curriculum, like when the students enter the college at the undergraduate level, they study the animal diversity under varied topics like the non-chordates and chordates, because if you are a student of zoology, first going to the other branches before going to the other branches like cell biology, molecular biology, first of all one should acquaint oneself with the animal diversity which is present around us and which is the basis of the zoology.
If we talk about animal diversity alone, in simple terms, how we would define it? Animal diversity, we are talking about their structuring kind of thing or something like that, or apart from that?
Animal diversity means the varied forms. Mm-hmm. So the animal diversity refers to all the different forms of animals. The differences may be in the shape, structure. The differences may be at the molecular level, differences may be at the cellular level, so organ level. So variety is there. So we can say, as I have talked about the protozoans, which are simply the unicellular organism. It means they are made up of a single cell. Mm-hmm. And that single cell is able to perform all the functions like digestion, respiration, excretion. That single cell is performing all those functions. But when we talk about the multicellular forms or the metazoans, the cells group together to form the organs. Organs group together to form a system. So like we talk about the human beings, we have got the different kinds of system. We have got the digestive system, respiratory system, and these different systems are being formed because of the coming together of different types of organs. And these organs are being formed because of the different kinds of tissues grouped together. So there are different levels of organization in the animal kingdom. It can be at the cellular level, it can be at the organ level, it can be at the system level. So according to that, we refer to them as the lower animals or the higher animals. If there is more complexity, they will be simply referred to as higher animals. If they are the simple forms, they will be called as the lower animals.
What do you mean by the complexity? How could we define complexity here?
Complexity here in terms of the structure, mm-hmm. You can say. As I told you, that complexity, each organism made up of a number of cells. And these number of cells put together to form the tissues which are responsible for different kinds of functions. So when there is integration of all these different forms of tissues and organs, they result in the higher forms of the animals.
And ma'am, as you said that we are talking about here about the variety, that is which differs. Is there a difference between the, if we talk about this diversity alone, because there are different categories of animals. If we talk about their aquatic animals also, amphibians also, does this variety changes for these animals?
Variety, generally the animals change or they have got the different structures to live in a particular kind of environment. If we talk about the fishes or if we talk about the amphibians, fishes totally aquatic, amphibians which lead a dual mode of life. They can live successfully on land as well as they can live in water. So for living a dual kind of life, they should have the structures which make them adaptable to live in both the kind of environment. So all these diverse forms of animal, whether they are aquatic or terrestrial, whether they are living an aerial life, like the insects which are able to have a wonderful flight. So all of them have definite kind of structures which make them successful to live in a particular kind of environment.
And as ma'am, we talk about if animals and if we not compare, but like in human beings, there are certain deformities. For example, the deformities in our structure. Does any problem or does anything happens with animals also? If we are talking about the animal diversity. So, is there this structuring is the cause of the deformity in animals also?
Actually, as human beings, we are more concerned about us. In animal kingdom also, there can be deformation in the structure, and these deformations are generally due to some kind of mutation in the environment. But all these animals, the diverse forms which we have grouped under different categories like the unicellular forms or the multicellular forms, human being is interested in those forms which are of some kind advantage or provide advantage to human being or cause a kind of inconvenience or cause disadvantage. So all those animal forms, like which we can say the economically important forms, like many of the protozoans, as I say, they are responsible for causing number of diseases in human beings. And the best known example is that of malaria. And as the monsoon arrives, you know, the mosquito number, it increases, and everyone becomes worried about, okay, if the mosquito is going to bite us, we are going to suffer from malaria or from dengue or from the other kind of diseases. So the human beings generally are interested in those forms of animal which are going to provide some kind of advantage or going to cause some kind of discomfort. So if variations we are able to find in these kind of things, like if we want to control the mosquitoes and we are going to apply the insecticides, so many of the mosquitoes, they become resistant to the insecticides. So it means the insecticide is not going to have any effect on that kind of mosquito. So now we will try to look for other means or try to look for some other chemicals by which we are able to control these forms. So if we talk about the deformities, we are not going to notice it so much because it is not going to cause a kind of discomfort to us.
Exactly. If we talk about, ma'am, species, for example, we are talking about a species of a particular animal. So can we say that it is the variation or the variety that is why we are having the number of species of a particular animal?
A variety of species occur in nature, and this evolution of a species, we can say, it takes place in response to the changing environment, because nature is never static. No, changes keep on taking place in nature, and today one kind of animal is present, okay? So, but it will keep on changing itself to adapt itself to the changing environment. Okay? So those species which are occurring in nature, they have occurred or they have evolved because of the changes which have occurred on this earth during the course of evolution. And it takes about a million of years for the formation of one species which is able to survive in nature. It is a very slow process, and the changes which take place, they will be transmitted to the coming generations very slowly.
If we talk about, as you said about the changing environment is the major cause that we find a variety of animals, or we say about the variety of species, but sometimes we talk about a particular species, for example, that particular species, for example, it is growing or upbringing in a different environment. For example, it was in forest but it has been brought to cities, and then it could be seen that, for example, the size of a particular dog is too much, but if we upbrings that a particular dog in cities, it is the cause of the environment that the size of that dog is small.
I don't think that size of this dog is going to change according to the environment. As I told you, it is a very slow process. If you have seen the giraffe, the long neck of giraffe, which is characteristic of it, that elongation of the neck of giraffe has taken thousands of years. The ancestors of giraffe were very small sized animals, but they have to graze on the branches of the trees, on the leaves of the trees, for which they have to straighten their neck, and they try to reach to the higher branches of the trees. So during the course of evolution, because of that stress on their neck, the neck of the giraffe has become elongated, but it has taken thousands of years. So as you say, that change in size of the dog, it is not going to occur in 1 year or 2 years or in hundreds of years. It may occur, we can say it is not impossible, it may occur because of the change in the environment, but again it is going to take lot of time.
Obviously, it would going to take a lot of time. What else are we going to study about in our next lecture, that is tomorrow?
Yeah. Now, as I told you, we have classified all these organisms on the basis of their symmetry, on the basis of their pattern of development. Now, we are going to concentrate on the other non-chordate phyla, like the sponges, mm-hmm. which belong to phylum Porifera, or like Hydra, I think all of us are familiar, which belongs to phylum Cnidaria, the worms responsible for causing so many of diseases, mm-hmm. the roundworms, the flatworms, the tapeworms. So, the earthworm, which belongs to other phylum, though we are calling it as a worm, mm-hmm. but it belongs to a distinct phylum, which is called as phylum Annelida. So, now we are going to focus on the characteristic features of different phyla, what specific features the organisms of these phyla have, how they can be distinguished from the members of other phyla, how we can classify the diversity of these different phyla so that it will be easy for us to understand them, to understand their structure and to understand their function.
Ma'am, many times we have heard about, for example, all those who are working in the laboratories, that a certain species, I would not say species alone, if we talk about certain embryos, they are kept at a very good temperature inside the laboratories. So, does temperature plays a very important role if we talk about the animals or the species or these embryos?
I think temperature and humidity, these are two factors which always play an important role in the development of all living organisms, whether it is plant or any kind of animal. If you are going to have the optimal conditions of temperature and humidity, then one is able to survive well. Like, similar, we can take a simple example of ourselves, not of the embryos. So, as the summer comes and the temperature is reaching 46 degrees Celsius or 42 degrees, we become so uncomfortable. We have loss of energy, we don't want to work, or there is so much of uneasiness in all of us. Because the temperature is not suitable for us. Similarly, for the development also, for the development of all the animals, there is an optimal temperature at which the suitable, at which the maximum development can take place.
For all the students of zoology who might be watching us, most of the students are always curious, what career do we have future? So, for the students of zoology, do you want to say anything?
I can say zoology is a diverse field. Zoology, the name is suggesting the animal science, but it is not only the animal science. The animals are involved in every field, whether we want to study the cell biology or at the molecular level, molecular biology, or we want to study the genetics of these animals, so, or we want to study the physiology of animals, biochemistry of these animals. So, varied fields are present in zoology, and a student at the undergraduate level studies a number of things about all these diverse fields. So, during the undergraduate program, one is familiar with the diverse branches of zoology, and later on at the MSc level, according to the interest of the student, they can go either for the doing MSc in zoology or MSc in environmental science, MSc in biomedical sciences, MSc in biochemistry or microbiology, which will pave the way for research in these fields. Simply, I can say even one can become the medical representative also.
Definitely.
Because one is familiar
Surely
with the
most
physiology.
Of these students who might be watching us, they might have got ample of career opportunities. With this note, thank you, ma'am. Thank you so very much for giving such a lively and productive lecture to all the students. And Dr. Renu Gupta would be again with us tomorrow with the same topic, and we'll be discussing new things and we'll be learning new. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you
thank
so
you
very
Deepika.
Much.